This is Greg Bafithis, the founder and chairman of Project Council. I'm here at the Langham Hotel in London covering the Georgetown Law Center's Institute, Corporate Counsel Institute, Europe. And I have the pleasure of having Nick Cooper, Corporate Services Director at Cable and Wireless, who just finished a panel, or participated in a panel, on corporate governance. Nick, thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Nick, one of the things at the panel was this whole concept of comply or explain. Can you just elaborate on that?
Yeah, we just had a very interesting session where I was pleased to share with your attendees some thoughts on governance in the UK. And governance in the UK is really about the comply or explain principle, which I think is one of our significant exports to the European Union as well. And we discussed the way that system works in practice. As a system, I think my feeling is that it is much better than a rules-based system. Comply or explain affords flexibility to boards. It allows for differences of opinion. I think what it recognises is that boards are genuinely different in their makeup, and they need to have the a variety of options open to them when they're making when they're making decisions. We also talked about governance and the impact on governance that disclosing information has, which is obviously puts boards under a huge obligation to make sure that the matters they're disclosing are right and that they have their affairs in order so they can make the right disclosures. Interestingly, one of the issues that came up in our session was about risk, also very topical at the moment in the light of the financial crisis. We had a great discussion on risk, and I think the point I wanted to make was rules-based systems tend to stultify board behaviour, and on risk in particular, in all of my 15 years of experience in watching boards and sitting on boards and in different capacities as a general counsel and company secretary and now as a fully-fledged PLC board member, would tell me that the biggest risk in business is not taking a risk at all. I think we talked about the potential impact that a rules-based system could have on corporate behaviour if we were obligated to deal with risk in a particular way. So I think the other thing about rules is they produce a lot of defensiveness in boards. I've seen a number of examples of board meetings where non-executives have felt very, very concerned about the level of information they're getting. What a shame. It's great to give non-executives information that they can look at their leisure and select from if they want to select from it. I think what you get in a rules-based system is defensiveness along the lines of where non-executives feel as though they have to read absolutely everything that you've sent them. And I can't believe that kind of stultification is necessarily the interests of good corporate governance, which I think thrives on frank, open debate and disagreements. So comply or explain, if we have to have a system of rules or a code, I think the flexibility in comply or explain is good. I prefer it significantly above any rules-based system. But I think beyond that, all of my practical experience tells me that neither code, whether it be comply or explain or a compulsory code, is in any way enough for good corporate governance. Good corporate governance, in my view, really is about behaviour. It's about the behaviour of boards. It's about individuals. It's about recognising that boards consist of a number of individuals. They're all different. Different desires to make impacts at board, different egos, different personal characteristics.
You talked about big boards don't work. Can you tell me a little bit more about that when you say big boards don't work?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think we've all been in sessions where there have been 20 people around the table. I mean, my thesis would be that in that size of meeting, it is simply not realistic to expect people to make a telling contribution that holds the whole meeting. So if I'm one of 20 and I believe I've got a check and balance point I want to make because I really do believe I'm right, human nature says that I won't be as confident to make that point. Maybe we'll have to make it much more forcibly to be heard amongst 20 people. The effect of what I say by definition would be diluted if it's one of 20 views. We've all had debates in small groups or on one-to-one, which may turn into very lively and heated debates. And how many times have you come across a debate where at the end of it, you felt you're much clearer on where you want to go at the end of it? It resolves a lot, it clarifies a lot, you hear different views, you fuse them together into a meaningful outcome. In a board of 10 or more, all of my experience says that the dynamics change and debates become much less satisfactory and slightly dysfunctional. And some of the quieter members of the board genuinely find it difficult to contribute in the bigger meeting. So looking at a committee meeting where you tend to have maybe four or five people in it, the nature of the discussion, the type of discussion and the style of the discussion is significantly different to a board of 15, 20 people and actually much more preferable in my view.
You also spoke about the role of the non-executive. Can you summarize some of your comments that you made at the panel?
Yeah, I mean, the role of the non-executive, in my view, is a key role. They are a group of people, and their genesis was always to sit on boards and hold boards to account. I think maybe the role of non-executives has fallen into a slight discredit in terms of some of the things that have happened in recent times, where maybe things have not worked the way that people imagine they should work. But that doesn't mean to say that the role of the non-executive is not the right role to conduct good corporate governance. So if I contrast the role of a non-executive against the role of a shareholder, a non-executive is a member of the board, they're independent, they're key, they're privy to all of the information that the board has, they're key to a level of information that the board has, and they're in the perfect position to hold the board to account. I think some of my frustrations with the role of the non-exec is that it's something where, given the importance of non-executives in holding boards to account, there's no training. There is no training for the role of non-exec. It's something that you can do without training on the back of a basic induction program from, say, a company secretary like I've been in the past. You can become a non-exec on a board. I think that's a shame, because I think what I see is I see some very good non-execs. I see less able non-execs. I see a whole range. What I don't see in some ways is consistency. I think that is a shame, because I think if we had clarity on the role of what a non-exec did, backed up by training programs where the role of the non-exec, rather than their experience that they bring to the table, which comes over a lifetime and in almost all cases is very distinguished, but understanding what non-execs do and the style to adopt in a non-exec in a behavioural environment like a board meeting, I think would improve things quite markedly. But, you know, the good non-execs are quite often not the ones you like the most. The good non-execs are the ones who really do put you under pressure and hold you to account. And, you know, I think, do they have to be experts in the business? No, I don't think they do. I think it helps, but I think, you know, when somebody has the experience of managing people, then I think what they're really looking at is when they question you, they really do understand whether they should be confident in your reply or whether they should question it. And a good non-exec is very effective.
And this concept of shareholders as custodians, can you elaborate on that?
I can. I mean, again, I it's an axiomatic belief that power without responsibility doesn't work. I mean, the key debate at the moment is obviously pay. Now, that's fine, and that's a perfectly valid debate. But, you know, I don't think one can take a position that people shouldn't be paid a particular rate or a particular amount unless you also deal with the issue, what were the consequences of not doing that? And those positions are perfectly valid, but you can't do one without the other. And I think if we have a system which effectively impinges on some of the key parts of what a chief executive should do, of what a board should do in terms of recruiting quality people and making sure they stay with you, then we are looking at a very dangerous situation if boards are left with the responsibility of that without having the ability to take the actions that make sure those things are correctly dealt with. So, yeah, I'm a big fan of not separating those two things. And in fact, I think it's a very, very dangerous corporate governance practice if power and responsibility do become separated.
You covered a lot of material on the panel. If there are one or two things that you hope people take away from that panel, what would they be?
I mean, this has been a legal conference, and it's great to get amongst legal colleagues and discuss matters. But, you know, I think we tend to focus on rules and regulations and codes and things we can read. I think corporate governance, we're all trying to find that golden goose that makes everything that's happened better and for us to confidently say it would never happen again. And I think personally, and we've all got different views, and I think who will be right will be proven over time, but this idea of behavioural governance, of behavioural scrutiny, of building systems around behaviours is the key for me. A code is important, but it won't go all the way. I think a focus on behavioural governance and how we can actually intensify behavioural governance is probably the missing ingredient in ensuring that boards perform the functions that you would want them to perform. So I think, you know, it's more awareness of that, I think, for me, and a greater discussion on that particular point, which I'd regard as key.
Nick, we sincerely appreciate you taking the time to chat with us.
Thank you.
This is Greg Biafidis, Chairman and Founder of Project Council, here at the Georgetown Conference at the Langham Hotel in London.